grab some coffee, a Mountain Dew, maybe both. A storm is brewing. The Brainstorm. Welcome to The Brainstorm with Matt and Mike.
Welcome to The Brainstorm with Matt and Mike. Hey, today we're kind of diving deep into some verticals and giving you like a 10 or 12 minute deep dive, as deep as you can get, marketing plan, marketing strategy in that vertical. This is a vertical that Mike is very used to because he drives around on one all the time, and it's really, really hot right now. And we're talking about business and industry that's kind of only popped up over the last 10, 12, 15 years, golf cart sales, almost like refurbished golf cart sales and service. And you don't have to have refurbished. You can get obviously brand new as well. But I know Mike's got one that's all jacked up and pimped out. It's really nice. And I come over and ride over it every now and then. But especially during these times, right now we're producing this show. It's right in the middle of a pandemic and COVID-19. Yep. And so people are riding around in social distancing on their golf cart. But Mike, you were telling me how that industry is booming right now.
Yeah, I'm hearing lots of chatter about new golf carts being sold right now. You know, people are at home and they're going stir crazy, and they probably have wanted one for a while. I'm not sure people are buying golf carts just on a whim. I think that they probably had the vision for buying one for a while, and now this has justified their purchase of that vehicle, that golf cart.
And, yeah, that makes sense.
And so it's, you know, it's not just used around golf courses. People are using them, in subdivisions. They use it to go to their community pool or to visit neighbors. If they live at the beach, they may have a condo or a townhouse or a
You probably
a villa.
Almost live on it if you're living, in any type
carry all their stuff down.
I was going to say if you live at the beach, you're almost living on it, but I guess you're right, Mike. I mean, you know, if you live in a subdivision with a community pool and it's got any distance
or tennis
to it,
courts,
right? Tennis courts or whatever.
Or just neighbors.
Yeah.
And so and they're not just your run-of-the-mill golf cart. I mean, most people are aware of this, that people do all types of things to trick them out. In fact, we gave away a few golf carts in the past few years at the local Columbia Fireflies.
Yeah, the baseball stadium. I thought that went well.
Yeah,
and let's say I'm in the market for a golf cart, but let's pretend I'm not.
Right.
Let's pretend that I'm not in the market for a golf cart specifically. I'm sitting around. I'm looking at my social media, which happens to be up over 48% right now, and I see one. Right. I see some like a carousel ad, maybe that's got a bunch of different kinds of golf carts.
Planting the seed.
Right. Mike, on a buyer's journey perspective, what's happening? What's happening right now as I see these social media ads, and where is it going to drive me? Like, how's it going to take me down the funnel?
Yeah. So obviously, if you're not already in the market or have some interest, you're going to be the longest sales cycle.
Yeah.
So what has to happen is you've got to pique someone's interest enough. You've got to use engaging. I would recommend video content or at minimum a lot of imagery that shows people using it in a variety of ways, showing how they, you know, don't have to hop in their car and get their seats wet to go down to the community pool, or they don't have to ride their bicycle down to the tennis courts or to visit their neighbors. They can hop on the golf cart with the kids, throw on the pool noodles and the floats and coolers and whatever, and just ride down to their pool or to their neighbor's house and have a good time. And so I think that it's really showing people the enjoyment side.
So it's allowing me or enabling me to picture myself
using
having satisfaction using it.
Yeah. And really kind of planting the seed of some pain associated with not having
it.
And so once you get beyond that, if you can get them to take an action, go to some type of website landing page, and then offer some type of content that would be almost irresistible for them to access.
Maybe build your own golf cart type of thing. Like that's cool, because I just happened to be in the market for a golf cart, just like you're talking about.
Yeah, right.
And I landed on a website that had a build your own golf cart.
That's
and
really
I was
cool.
Like, oh yeah, no, I've spent a significant amount of time pimping out my own golf cart. And I hadn't pulled the trigger, but I've already redesigned it about four times.
So if it was our client, Matt, you know what would happen next. That you would be pimping that golf cart out, using your language there, and then at the end of your pimp out, it would, for you to see it in full and get the price or an idea of the price, you would just have to provide a little bit of information, probably just name, email address, maybe a phone number, maybe not yet. you're going to have been far enough in that process that most likely you're going to provide it.
Yeah.
And that's then going to add you as a contact, in this case, to a customer relationship management software, a database, customer database, that then adds you to a list and triggers some type of action-based email campaign to further inform you and excite you about the prospect of purchasing a golf cart, constantly calling you to the strongest call to action possible, which is schedule a consult or call us to find out availability.
Or to get your custom build going on that type of stuff. And then I'm assuming whether I take action or not, if I, you know, 10, 15, 20 minutes down the road, if I go back to my social media feed, I'm assuming that I'm going to see the exact golf cart.
If we were handling it, they would be.
Right? In a retargeting ad.
Yeah. If you went to YouTube, you would see a pre-roll ad.
Yep.
No matter what you're looking for.
Yep.
If you went in some at some television stations, you might, in digital, you might see,
still see an
a
ad,
commercial for
a display ad.
That's right.
Oh, I mean, yeah. You're talking about television. So now you've done crossed over into OTT television, which is over the top streaming services.
That's right.
And those things work really, really well. It's kind of the mix between digital and television. They're bringing digital to television.
Yeah. And so some people are going to make quicker buying decisions. Again, if you weren't interested to begin with, you're probably going to take longer. So they need a series of messages in retargeted social media, email, and as many different mediums really as possible to continue to pull you back, to keep you engaged, to keep you excited, and to further inform you so that way you can justify your emotion-based decision of buying a golf cart.
Yeah, no, that makes perfect sense. And so we're talking about a golf cart that usually is going to have a price point anywhere between, I would say, maybe $5,000 and $10,000.
Yeah, or more today. I mean, these
Yamaha.
Or maybe
even more, maybe $12,000, $15,000.
It's crazy.
Right.
I mean, you know, I didn't pay that for mine. But yeah, definitely people are spending a lot of money on these things.
Yeah, and so the reason why I bring that up is because if you have a price point of any product that you might sell of between between $5,000 and $15,000, that's a product like this. It could be a recreational vehicle, could be a motorcycle, could be a jet ski, four-wheeler,
jet ski, dirt bike,
right? Any type, all of that type of thing goes just like this, right?
Yeah. And those side-by-sides, man, those can get up in the 20s and 30s,
right,
maybe even more. So they can get, and then you move into watercraft, and of course the price point goes
boats,
through the roof.
They start, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Right.
But it's the same tactics.
Yeah.
It's literally the same tactics. Like, you have some type of disruption-based advertising that's engaging enough no matter what you do, which is, hey, listen, if you think about television commercials and radio commercials and billboards, Mike, I mean, nobody drives down the street to see the billboards.
No.
Nobody watches television to watch the commercials. It's interruption-based advertising. So it has to be engaging enough to, when it does interrupt you, to like have some interest.
Yeah.
Like strike some interest into you, right? Enough to where you then want to go online.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, people talk about running TV commercials and radio commercials and billboards. And as you know, we're not biased to anything and not necessarily turned off by any type of media. I mean, we want to vet it all
whatever
out.
Works.
Whatever works. And it's different things are going to work for different people, right? But here's what we do. We're going to tie, from a strategy perspective, what you want to do is you want to tie those things together. You want to make sure you understand who the target market is. You want to understand how to then use that type of advertising, right, to convey the message that you crafted. So you have to craft the right message based off the target market.
That's right.
Then you have to
use
that.
In the right channel.
In the right channel. And then you have to you have to convey the message using whatever it is that you're going to use, the medium, right? But then the key is making sure you drive them to a piece of content that can nurture it.
That's right.
That can bring them through that journey that you're talking about.
Yeah, and where I think we see most advertisers fall short is they want the first date to become the ceremony for marriage. And so they're wanting to reach someone and they want them to buy now. People aren't going to buy a $10,000 golf cart purchase most of the time in one visit when they've not even had an interest in buying a golf cart.
Yeah, my example,
that,
right.
Unless they are really, really spontaneous buyers and they probably have some issues.
And with that being the case though, I mean, that's a good point that you're making. You might not want to run just interruption based advertising. You might want to wait until someone strikes some interest And then comes to your landing page or comes to a website or something of that nature, and then use your budget for retargeting purposes. Because now you're at least advertising to people who've shown some interest in what you're doing. Right.
So, you know, if you, well, you could geo-target areas where you know that it's common for people to have golf carts.
That's a good point.
Lifestyles, age groups, demographics, income levels.
Yeah.
Very targeted. Certain hobbies.
Very targeted.
So are all indicators that someone is likely to also have an interest in buying, in this case, a golf cart.
Right. Or any other product that we were just talking about a minute ago, like a boat or jet ski or whatever the case may be. No, that's excellent. That's a really good point. Video, I know, works really, really well when it comes to that, right? I mean, it can almost put yourself in it.
Yeah.
Right? And so video, I know, is very...
Can't have enough video content.
Very consumed. It's consumed all the time. So it's a great way of doing it. We're going to jump into manufacturing and distribution. So this is more for folks that are more B2B types of organizations. And we know that those things that you struggle with, the strategies, everything about what you do and how you do it is different. Mike has been spending a lot of time in this industry or these industries because he's got a handful of clients that he's working with right now in that space.
Yeah.
Mike, talk to us a little bit about a marketing strategy associated with manufacturing distribution.
So so what we find is oftentimes it's high value sales. It's longer sales cycles. And, you know, they're usually making decisions, you know, oftentimes for the future. So they're not looking to make
it's
always
not an
a
immediate
purchase
thing,
tomorrow
right.
or even next month. It might be 6 months. It might be 12. It might be 2 years down the road.
Yeah. Especially in the manufacturing piece.
Yeah, if you're making a part that has to go on some type of, you know, along with something else, they may be specking that product out, you know, years in advance.
Right.
And so you've got to be building a momentum with those audiences well in advance. And you got to stay in front of them frequently. So what they've historically done, we see a lot of people in this space go to a lot of trade show events, a lot of large association industry events, so they can engage with their target market and build rapport, build relationships. And then a lot of them are manually trying to follow up with all of these people. And what we know is that there's only so much time in the day, and you can write it down in your little book, but inevitably what happens is people get busy and they start chasing the things that seem hottest right now.
Yeah.
And they forget to cultivate all those other relationships.
The long-term that they relationships.
Could have had had they stayed front and center. And so what they really need is a solid, ongoing communication system with lots of value-add content that reaches them and educates, informs, entertains, and builds brand. You know, brand building is such an important factor in these industries because, again, people aren't making one-time, split-second buying decisions in most cases for the lion's share of these people in the manufacturing distribution space.
You know, what I like about some of our conversations that we have here at the Brainstorm and on our show, Mike, is it's kind of cross-pollinated into other industries, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of this type of stuff goes together.
Sure.
And so when you're talking about how a lot of in the manufacturing distribution space or sometimes can be chasing the sell right now and not staying in touch with and cultivating and kind of just creating a pipeline, if you will, for future sales.
Yep.
And then later on, you're having to do the same thing because you didn't do it earlier.
Yeah.
I know in one of our previous shows, we talked about how, I think it was maybe in one of the shows where we gave some weight to some memes and things of famous quotes that we did. And one of them just said, which actually resonated with me, that a year from now, you're going to wish you started today.
That's right.
And so that's a really good point. And so that, what I wanted to, the reason why I bring that back up and stopped you there is because it just, that can be in every business, in every industry.
Yeah,
but
it almost
especially is when you're having big price points or in the manufacturing distribution sector.
So, you know, if you're manufacturing, you have a lot of different types of employees on your team. You have people who are actually in the manufacturing facility. You've got sales, you've got accounting, you got, you know, it's a large volume oftentimes of different types of occupations. So having video content to educate them who's behind the scenes making things happen, what's it look like, what's your safety ratings like. I mean, people want to connect in that space with companies who think like they do, who value partnerships at the same rate that they do. And And so really putting that information out there as part of the communication plan, reaching them across all channels, definitely using a CRM, marketing automation, because there's not enough time in the day, and you can have automated messaging going out at a predetermined frequency, yeah, and then track their behavior. And based on their behavior, do they click through? Did they open? They click through? Did they visit certain pages of content? Did they watch a video? And based on certain triggers, the content they engage with, it can shift and put them in a campaign that's most relevant to them, and then notify the sales force when someone is ripe.
You know, it amazes me, Mike, and I know it does you as well. It amazes me on how many businesses don't employ some type of automated CRM platform or software system.
Yeah.
I mean, I still talk to people today. It's like, oh, I don't have any type of CRM. I just write it down on a piece of paper.
Yeah, the Rolodex.
They don't get email addresses. I mean, we're way past those times.
Yeah.
Right? We're way past those times. You absolutely have to employ some type of CRM and marketing automation system, because if you're not, you're always going to be working this hard.
Yeah.
However hard you're working right now, it's never going to get better.
Yeah.
And it's going to be so hard to scale. Right. To continue to scale up.
You're always chasing the next sale instead of,
and you're always hiring new salespeople.
Healthy pipeline that's like the snowball effect, yeah, that builds momentum. So while you are still chasing some sales, and you're more than that, building stronger rapport with your existing customers,
right,
and your soon to be customers.
Because you're staying in touch with them.
You're in touch
you're
with
literally
them.
Communicating. Imagine that. Communicating offers you almost have to, it's really fulfillment. I mean, like, you're giving them immediate satisfaction by staying in touch with them. It's amazing to me how many people don't do it.
Yeah. So the key is just putting the message out there, staying front and center, keeping your brand visible to them, adding value to them, even outside of the sales process. And sometimes adding value that's not necessarily even part of your offerings, but you know it's valuable to your audience.
Right.
So people want to engage people who add value to them. And so the giver's gain, like BNI's model, which holds true no matter what.
Right. Yeah, there's no doubt. And networking is a great way. You just mentioned BNI. It's a great way to, you know, just stay in touch. In the manufacturing distribution, you know, those types of networking might not be as fruitful as consumer services based things. But
it
depends on which, you know, it depends on what networking groups you're with, right? There's networking that that's all about. I know that you've gone to a handful of trade shows, and our team, some of our team members have gone to a handful of trade shows specifically for some of our manufacturing and distribution clients. Those trade shows are completely different than the local home show.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you're talking spending, you know, oftentimes six figures to just be, yeah, to be present. And a lot of time from some key personnel away from, you know, the manufacturing facility, away from home base. And so it's time. It's a big financial investment. And what we see is so often people get excited. They prepare to go to these events, and then they don't really maximize the opportunity because they're only going to usually a few of these a year.
Right.
And you see somebody a few times a year, you can build some excitement, but it's usually flash in the frying pan, and it doesn't last because people have so many other distractions, so many other messages, so many other people courting them, that even if they liked what they saw at an event, if you don't have a good follow-up system that stays in front of them and continues to engage them and nurture them, you're going to lose them.
I remember a trade show that you and I went to years ago. I don't even remember how long. It probably is 8-10 plus years ago. And we went to a trade show, and we up front picked out about 15 or 20 prospective clients, mm-hmm, that we really wanted to meet. You remember that? Mm-hmm. And we put together this really cool thank you package. I call it a thank you pack or a gift pack.
Like a welcome pack.
A client pack. In that case, a welcome pack of a cooler and t-shirts and tumblers and all types of stuff with what appeared to be a handwritten note inside of it asking for an opportunity for them to stop by our booth and meet us.
Yeah.
Right.
And it worked.
Every single one of them, literally every single
like
one
that.
Of them. And we paid the trade show people to put it in their hotel room. Mm-hmm. Right. And then every single one of them stopped by and thanked us for that welcome package. and gave us an opportunity. We ended up closing two or three of those clients too.
That's right.
And so that type of thing really works. Kind of do that research up front when you're going to these big trade shows and putting together some type of incentive to stop by your trade show booth, especially in those trade shows. Because you told me, Mike, one of them happened to be like hundreds of acres of trade show.
Massive.
So yeah, you have to really get creative when it comes to that type of stuff. What I'm hearing is make sure you have a good CRM marketing automation tool. Make sure you're always cultivating new opportunities by staying in touch and communicating with all of the people that you have segmented inside that CRM, correct?
Yeah, you build your database and then you nurture that database.
Yeah.
You continue to cultivate that database. And you continue to put more into the top of the database.
Right. Yeah, so that's the manufacturing distribution industry, man. We love doing this. This is what we do all day, every day. We create marketing strategies that work for different types of businesses and different types of industries. It works very, very well. So we appreciate you joining us here on the Brainstorm with Matt and Mike. If you're watching via our YouTube channel, that's great. Thank you. If you're listening to us live on the radio Monday mornings, or if you're subscribed to our podcast, thank you for listening to the Brainstorm with Matt and Mike.